So today's session is all about API security. So APIs are everywhere, right? They are hosted, they are in IoT devices, they are everywhere. So when we are thinking about developing an API, API security should not be an afterthought. Right? So it should be integrated to the very early stages of API design. And when you're designing, one of the key aspects that you have to think about is your audience. Who's going to use your API? So it can be a public API or a private API, right? It can be consumed by an end user or by an application. So depending on who the audience is, the mechanisms you are going to use to secure your API, it changes, it differs. Right. So you don't secure an API, a private API in the same way as public API and vice versa. Okay. So when we are talking about a secure design, be it an API or anything, there are six key attributes that you have to be concerned about. One is authentication. So only the legitimate user should be allowed to access the system, access the API. Then authorization. Those legitimate users should must not do anything more than what they are allowed to do. Okay? Then confidentiality. The private data should be viewed only by the expected recipients. And then the integrity. So the data should not get missed in between the communication channel, right? Integrity should be protected. Then non-repudiation. So someone can't just send a request to an API and then tell, okay, I didn't send it. Right. Finally, availability. So all the users should be able to access your APIs at all given times. So if your API has these six key attributes, then we can tell that's a secured API. So within this session, what we are going to look into is how different protocols and mechanisms help you to achieve these six attributes, to have these six attributes in your APIs. So we are mainly going to talk about the authentication and authorization mechanisms, right? And finally, the other four. Okay, so going in back in time, HTTP basic authentication, right? We all know what this is. It's simple kind of username password authentication, right? You simply send an HTTP authorization header with the API request. So the gateway will do a simple login, simple authentication using the username and password. So username and password will be base 64 encoded, but still, it's in clear text. I can easily reverse it, right? So it's a must that you protect the transport using TLS or some other transport protection mechanism. So WSO2 API Manager has a basic auth handler. So you can simply use that if you actually require basic authentication for your APIs. So the problem with basic auth, it was sent in clear text. Password is there, right? So people came up with HTTP digest authentication to get rid of that problem. So in this mechanism, your password is never sent in clear text. Password is never sent, actually. A digest or a hash derived from the password and a couple of other attributes like username, realm, HTTP method, and etc. That hash will be sent across the wire. So you don't need SSL if you are using digest authentication. But this is a bit complex, right? So if you want digest authentication in API Manager, you should use a custom handler, and you can simply implement that. Right. So a quick overview of what we discussed so far, basic and digest authentication. So basic code sends credentials in clear text, digest or never sends credentials in clear text, rather sends a digest or a hash. So basic auth must use some transport securing mechanism. Digest auth doesn't depend on such a mechanism. Okay. This is a key point. Basic authentication only performs authentication. In contrast, digest auth can perform both authentication plus integrity protection. So when a client is sending a digest auth request or a digest with HTTP request, then it can mention some parameter called quality of protection, QOP. So if QOP equals to auth int, that means authenticate plus integrity protect, your HTTP response, HTTP body, entity body will also get hashed. So it makes sure it's authenticated and as well as integrity protected. Okay. Then how it is stored? In basic code, you can store and you should ideally store in a salted as a salted hash in your user store. Right. When the auth header comes, then the server will try to create the same hash and compare. In digest auth, you need to store it either in clear text or store the hash of username password realm, which is the hash that's coming in the wire, to compare with what's coming in the wire. So these are the key differences between these quite old authentication mechanisms. Then we have another traditional one, TLS mutual auth. Right? So this is mainly used within a trusted subsystem. So in this scenario, there's an application server, so that's the client, and then another application's hosting APIs, which we can think of as the gateway, API gateway. API gateway trust the client. They are in the same trust subsystem. So client will use certificates to authenticate with the API gateway, right? So gateway will does the certification validation, and then if you require further fine-grained authorizations, the authorization server can do that after the initial SSL validation. So this also we don't have it out of the box, but we have done it as custom handlers for several customers. So you can also have this as a security handler. Okay. So basic auth, digest auth, TLS, mutual auth. All these traditional mechanisms has one key limitation. If the client, if the application is accessing the API on behalf of a user, that user has to share his or her credentials with that app, right? Some very popular example, Twitter, some years back, they asked for my email username and email password. So they can go inside my email account and check whether there are any friends who already has a Twitter account, right? So they basically have the full authentication, full privileges to my Gmail account or whatever email provider, right? So that was very common. So that was a key, a common problem among the REST community, and they wanted a better solution, an alternative for these traditional mechanisms. That's where OAuth comes into the picture. So the problem OAuth tries to solve is how to allow an application to do an API request on behalf of a user without having his or her credentials. A very simple example, most probably you encounter OAuth in everyday life. Maybe you even don't know. You go to YouTube, right? You see a very nice video, and now you want to push it into, publish it in your Facebook timeline. What you do? You go to YouTube and click share with Facebook, right? Then a login page pops up. Not from YouTube, but of Facebook. So you are giving your credentials to the place which owns your credentials, to your identity provider, right? So it's trustworthy. So you authenticate, and then it asks for your consent. Do you like to allow YouTube to post this in your timeline? You say yes, right? Then only YouTube will go ahead and do that post. But Can YouTube send a message to your friend? No. So what YouTube got was what we call as an OAuth access token with a restricted set of permissions. We call it as a scoped token. You can't do everything and anything, right? You only can do publish this video to the timeline. That's what I have consented to. So you probably encounter this in all the social sites, right? So OAuth is working behind all of them. Sorry, I just flipped the slide. Yeah. So there are two variants. One is three-legged OAuth, and the other one is two-legged OAuth. So in three-legged OAuth, there are three parties. Client, that's the application. Resource server, that's the API gateway. And a user, right? One, two, three legs, three parties, three-legged OAuth. Then two-legged OAuth, what's missing is a user. We have the client and the resource server. Right. Client will act as the resource owner. All right? Okay. So OAuth came as OAuth 1.0. Then it had a very critical vulnerability. And soon it was replaced with OAuth 1.0a. So developers, most of the developers, found it very restrictive to implement their use cases, right? Very cumbersome. It involves signatures and et cetera. So from all the popular current these social sites and websites, only Twitter uses OAuth 1.0a still. Google, Facebook, LinkedIn, all have moved towards OAuth 2.0. So OAuth 2.0, in contrast to OAuth 1.0a, is kind of an authentication framework. It's not a standard itself. So you can implement your own custom authorization scenarios or use cases in OAuth terminology, what we call as grant types, using OAuth 2.0. So if you take the WSO2 API management platform, you can simply write a grant type to cater your custom use case and plug it to this extensive OAuth framework in the API management platform and get your scenario up and running. That's the beauty of OAuth 2.0. It's very flexible. All right. So there are numerous use cases that OAuth can be used for. I am listing here only the main four use cases, or what we call as grant types. That's the authorization code grant, which is suitable for web applications. So if you take Facebook login, Google login, LinkedIn login, all these social logins use authorization code grant type. So we will look into a small illustration on how this authorization code grant flow happens in the next slide. So before that, the next grant is implicit grant. So there are some applications which are public, which are untrusted, right? There are single page applications and mobile applications. So implicit grant is intended for such applications, right? Then resource owner credential grant. So this is the good old, the same basic code story kind of a thing, where you give your credentials to the application, where you gave your credentials to Twitter to go ahead and do something, right? So resource owner credential grant is the same thing as that. So the application takes your credentials and then go ahead and do the API request. So this should be used only if the apps are trusted by that API or the service. For example, the official app of Facebook is trusted enough for the Facebook, right? So it can take the credentials and then transmit them to Facebook, right? Okay. Then finally, client credentials grant. So this is a two-legged scenario where only the client and the resource server are there. So this is suitable to retrieve data that is not specific for an end user, like weather data, stock codes, and etc., or machine-to-machine communications. In fact, this was introduced to help the developers who have developed basic OAuth applications to migrate into the OAuth framework, right? So the client credentials mean the client applications client ID and secret, like username and password, like basic code. Right? Okay. So WSO2 API manager platform supports all of these grants out of the box. Okay. So this is the authorization code grant that I talked about. This is what happened underneath that YouTube to Facebook communication when you try to post your video on a Facebook timeline. So first, user tries to access the client. Then client, that's the YouTube, redirects the user to the authorization server, which is the Facebook. User authenticates in step 3. Authorization server sends something called authorization code. It's not an access token. So this is the first phase. Then something happened behind the lines. Right. YouTube or the client sends a back channel request to authorization server, the Facebook, sends this authorization code and request an OO2O access token. Okay. So once the access token is received, now client can call API gateway with that access token in number 7. Gateway will send that token to the authorization server, or the key manager, we call it as, for validation. If it is valid, all right, the request will go to the backend API. Right. So that's the simple flow of authorization code grant, and this is the most popular and most secure grant type, because even the user doesn't know about access token. It's a back channel thing. All right. So based on O2O, there are various very interesting scenarios that you can come up with. Right. For example, now your company wants to give users the ability to social login. Use their social logins for the authorization flow. Use Facebook for login. Now previously, the authorization server was internal, right? This is where user authenticated. This is where access token was issued. Now we are going to decouple that. We are going to decouple end user authentication from authorization server. Okay. So what happens is, let's think that identity provider as Facebook, and this authorization server as API manager. Right. So when the client sends a request to the authorization server, authorization server will do a redirect to identity provider. If it's Facebook, it will redirect to Facebook. And user log in at Facebook, and response comes back. Now authentication part is done. Authorization server can go ahead and give the access token, and the rest of the flow will continue. Right? So that's interesting use case. Now let's think you already have XAML authentication in your web applications, right? So XAML is the most popular protocol for single sign-on. So you already have an application using XAML. You have a XAML token, XAML assertion for a user. Now you don't want to get this user authenticated again, right? So he's already authenticated to the app. You want to access an API. You don't want the user to get authenticated again from API manager. This is where XAML bearer grant type comes into picture. What you do is, you give the XAML token, so the first 1, 2, 3 that is getting a XAML token, and then you give the XAML token in the 4th step to the authorization server or API manager and get an access token on behalf of that. Right. So you exchange the XAML token to an OAuth token. And now you can access the API using that OAuth token. You don't need to authenticate the user again for the OAuth flow or the authorization flow. Here's another one. Now, what if you have an OpenID Connect authentication? Previously, it was XAML, right? Similarly, OpenID Connect has an ID token or a JWT. Right? So you can exchange your JWT to an access token, right? It's the same flow. So XAML grant type And this Facebook authentication, we already have them out of the box in our API management platform. JWT grant type, we have already implemented, and it's in the final stage of review. It will be there very soon. Okay. And another one is NTLM. Think you are in a Windows domain. Your user is already authenticated to the domain. Now your application wants to access an API in the same domain. Right? Should you ask the user to log in again? No. But the API is secured with OAuth tokens, not Windows tokens. In the same manner you did previously, what you are going to do is you are going to exchange your NTLM or Windows token to an OAuth token. Right. Get an access token, then you can go ahead with your authorization flow. Right. So we already have this in our API management products. Then there's an interesting grant type. This is not very frequently used, called the chained grant type. Now you have your client has accessed an API. Now what if this API wants to access another API downstream on behalf of the same user? That's where this grant types comes into picture. So what the authorization resource server will do is, it will give the original access token to the authorization server and request another access token so it can access the downstream API. The previous access token is owned by the client, not by the resource server. Right? So this one is generated for the resource server. Okay? So ideally, the restrictions or the scopes should be similar to the original scopes or more restricted in this grant type. So we don't have this out of the box, but we have already done several custom implementations, so it is doable, right? Using our extensible, the custom handler mechanism. Okay. So coming to something called token introspection. So what we have discussed is getting an OAuth token, right? So what happens between when you send an OAuth token to the gateway and gateway sends that token to the authorization server for validation? Okay. So sometimes it can be the same thing. Resource server can act as the authorization server as well. But it can be decoupled as well. So what if it is decoupled? Currently, most of the implementations are proprietary implementations. How this communication happens is proprietary. Right. So if one company have an API management product, its resource server will gateway will communicate with its authorization server in a proprietary manner. So token introspection profile on top of OAuth is built to standardize that. So what's the advantage of it? You are not coupled, you are not bound to a particular authorization server. You can use API management gateway, but your key management can be done even with some outside, external, not WSO2, some outside key management server. You still can call that and validate your token. That's the beauty of standards, right? So that's what token introspection profile is all about. So when you send your token, you will get a response from the authorization server saying the client ID, the scopes, subject, and audience. So once you get that, once API management gateway gets that, it can continue either to allow the API request to go ahead or do further fine-grained authorization controls. So coming into the fine-grained authorization controls, we can't forget. It's not working. Okay, yeah, so we can't forget about SACML, That's the next slide. Okay. So SACML is the de facto standard for, okay, we are good, fine-grained authorization. All right. So from the, okay, it's not working. Okay. From the introspection or from the key validation, we got the scopes and the subject and client ID and everything. Now you have the details. API Gateway has the details to do further fine-grained authorization, right? So what it will do is, it will pass those information to an SACML engine, what we call as a SACML PDP, and ask whether this should be permitted or not. Then according to the policies at SACML engine, the SACML engine, which can be either features, SACML features installed on top of API manager, or which can be WSO-ID server running as a standalone product, will tell whether this is permitted or denied. It can be based on subject's age or any value. Right. Okay, yeah. So it's... There's a lag. Yeah. All right, so anyway. There's one more slide in between. I will skip that, I think. So this is quite an interesting area. User-managed access. Right? So we talked about OAuth all the time. Right? We talked about authentication. Now, in OAuth, what OAuth tries to solve is how, do you remember that? How a client can access an API on behalf of a user without sharing credentials. So that is delegation between a person to an application. Okay. Now, UMA is concerned about, or user-managed access is concerned about, delegation between a person to another person. You got the idea? Let's take a simple example. In Google Drive, you create a doc. You create a spreadsheet. Right? Now, you click share. You tell, okay, let's say Luke created a doc. Luke click share and give John permissions to view and Peter permissions to edit. What did you do just now? Person to person delegation. Right? OAuth itself can't handle that. So there are a lot of implementations, like the example I gave just now in Google. There are a lot of other implementations which are proprietary. So how Google does that is proprietary. What user-managed access tries to do is standardize that. This is quite interesting, right? Like the age OAuth came into the picture, this is a big thing. So this is still a draft. But there's a lot of enthusiasm around this. And since we are in this IoT world, right, there are a lot of use cases UMA can solve. Let's say you're in a home, there's a mother and a son and a housekeeper. Now there's a security camera, intent connected. Right. Son can do anything. He can view the stream or he can move the camera. But housekeeper can only view. Now, what if housekeeper wants to move the camera, right? She needs to request that. So UMA automate all of those. A person-to-person delegation. That mother delegates access to another person, the housekeeper or the son, right? Okay, so let me briefly go through the flow. UMA introduces a new party to the OAuth flow, called requesting party. That's the housekeeper or Peter in Google Docs, right? Then there's a resource server, authorization server, client, resource owner, everything same as OAuth. What happens is, here the resource owner will have policy in the authorization server, and the resource server will register itself in the authorization server. For example, Facebook will go and register itself in a central authorization server. YouTube will do the same. LinkedIn will do the same. Right? There will be policies created by the resource owner, by me. Right? Then when someone else wants to access, that centralized authorization server can automatically give decisions based on those policies. So that's the very limited overview of UMA standard. So we have already developed that as a Google Summer of Code project. And we are reviewing that, and it will be there in our product very soon. Right? And there are only very quite a few number of implementations out there yet, because this is still an ongoing specification. Okay. Yeah. So we have talked about authentication and authorization. Now there are other aspects like confidentiality. So how you can secure the make sure your APIs are confidential. So you can use TLS or JSON web encryption, right? And for integrity, you can use JSON web signatures. For non-repudiation, again JSON web signatures. And for availability, what you can do is you can have network controls where it throttles user-wise or per client, so it will stop any denial of service attacks. Right? So similar measures can be taken to force those other four key attributes of a secured design.